We want to welcome everyone to our morning service. We're glad that you're here, especially if you're visiting with us, and we have a number of visitors with us this morning. However, two of our members are not able to be with us this morning. J.T. Beard and Scott Floyd are on the fall mission trip to Guyana. We heard from them this morning or last night that they are doing well, and they've had eight baptisms so far in the meetings that they've had. So please remember them as they are in Guyana for the next 2 weeks. Thank you for being part of our big day today, and we're always glad to have Mike Eaton to come back home where he's supposed to be. But we're here to worship God this morning. Let's begin with a prayer. Our Father, thank you for the opportunities that we have to come together, hear from your word. And Father, we pray that you will help us to live that abundant life that we're talking about today. Be with us and help us to do the right things. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
First song will be number 718. 718, we shall assemble on the mountain.
That's all saying.
We shall assemble on the mountain. We shall assemble at the throne. With humble hearts into his presence. We bring an offering of song. Glory and honor and dominion.
pray with me, please. Father in heaven, what a beautiful day you've given us today. What a beautiful day for us to come together. What a beautiful day. We are so truly blessed. Father, we're so thankful that you've given us choices. You've given us free will, Father. We need to remember, Father, that the choices we make, that they affect others, not only ourselves. And that as we make these choices, Father, we must remember to always use your guidance. Keep us going in the right direction. Dear Father, our thoughts, our words, our behavior is truly a reflection of who you are. It is truly a reflection that if we do the right thing, where we learned it from. Dear Father, we thank you for every page of the Bible, every single word. We thank you for this church of Jesus Christ. We are so thankful, and so thankful, Father, that Jesus came here and that he died for each and every one of us. And may we never, ever forget this. And may we always know that that is the most important thing. And we always know that we don't deserve what we have been given by this gift. And it is in Jesus' sweet name that we pray. Amen.
If you are using a songbook, you can mark number 943 as a song of encouragement this morning. Before Brother Mike comes and speaks to us, we're going to sing three songs. Number 66 will be our first song. If you would please stand for these three.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Thank you.
We're so glad you're here today to join us for this big day as our brother Mike Eaton speaks to us about abundant living. Glad to have Mike and his wife Missy with us here today. Of course, we're grateful for his parents, Harold and Martha, as they continue to worship with us here. We love them, we love this family, and we're thankful that, as Mike said this morning, he's able to come home. Mike has been preaching for the church in Camden for about 11 years, 11 plus years, but is soon going to be making a move to Pineville, Louisiana. And of course, we want to keep him in our prayers as he makes that move and for the success of that work there. His children, John Michael and Mallory, are both students at Harding and doing well from what I understand. Mike has attended school at both Freed Hardeman and Harding School of Theology, having obtained a bachelor's degree, a master's in counseling, and also a master of divinity. But more than that, what we see in Mike is a love for God, a love for his people, and a love for his word. We're so thankful that he's here with us today to share with us about abundant living, and I invite you now to listen attentively as he shares with us yet another lesson. All right.
Well, thank you. I'll give you your paycheck later. That's marvelous. I wish I could take Greg with me everywhere to do those introductions. And I wish I could take all of you great singers with me back to Camden and let you show our congregation how singing's supposed to be done. That was wonderful. That was very uplifting for me, and I appreciate that. And Nathan Pirtle, wow, he can lead singing almost as well as he can fish. That was great. Nathan, I really enjoyed that. God bless you for being here this morning. It's a joy for me to get to be with you and share this big day with you. And I think there's some big eating planned, and I'm particularly looking forward to that. And then the 1 o'clock service, and I hope you'll be here. And we'll try to keep it a little briefer this afternoon, and I hope you'll come and be with us to close out the day at 1 o'clock. You gave me a firm foundation here growing up from first grade all the way through high school. This was my church, my home church. And I appreciate the solid foundation you gave me. You helped pay my way through Freed Hardeman to train to be a preacher. And I will always be eternally grateful for what you've meant to me through the years. And I promise you, I'll never forget you. I'll never quit appreciating you. And I promise I will never stray from that firm foundation that you gave me. Thank you so very, very much. I told you that Miss Juanita Pounds was my Sunday morning, first grade Sunday school teacher, and I remember that. Isn't it something that I can remember first grade Sunday school here, but I can't remember what I did yesterday? It's funny how that works. But there was one first grade Sunday school teacher that told the boys and girls to bring an object for show and tell the next Sunday morning that reminded them something about Jesus' teaching. And so the next Sunday rolled around, and they all had their objects, and they were excited about showing and telling. And the teacher called them up one by one and held out her hand for there to put the object in the teacher's hand and then tell about it. And the first little child came up and put a piece of loaf bread in the teacher's hand and said, "This reminds me that Jesus said, 'I am the bread of life.'" And the teacher said, "That's good." And the next child came up with a salt shaker and sprinkled salt in the teacher's hand and said, "Jesus said, 'You are the salt of the earth.'" And the teacher bragged on that child. The next child came up with a flashlight, put a flashlight in the teacher's hand and said, "Jesus said, 'You are the light of the world.'" And the teacher said, "That's fantastic." Now the next little boy came up and he was hiding his object behind his back so she couldn't see. And she held out her hand, and he slapped a raw egg in her hand and broke it in her hand, and it was running through her fingers. And she said, "Son, what is the meaning of this?" And he said, "Well, Jesus said, 'Take my yoke upon you.'" I don't know what burdens and weights and yokes you may be bearing this morning, but I promise you, if they're not yokes that Jesus put on you, they're too heavy, and they're heavier than you have to bear. In Matthew 11, verses 28 through 30, Jesus said, "Come unto me, all ye that are weary." Have you ever been weary? Have you ever been sick and tired? Have you ever been sick and tired of being sick and tired? Would this election please be over? Please, Lord, let it be over come this Tuesday. Have you ever been weary? Jesus said, "Come to me, all ye that are weary and heavy laden, and come to me, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart. And you shall find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I think sometimes some of my brethren enjoy being martyrs. They enjoy carrying around weights that they really don't have to carry. All they have to do is unload them at the foot of the cross. And Jesus will put a different yoke or burden upon them, but it'll be lighter than the one they've been trying to carry through life. I wonder if there's some things you're carrying through life that you really don't have to do. Jesus came, John 10:10, to give you life, and that you might have that life more abundantly. But the abundant life that Jesus came to give you is your choice. He can't force it upon you. There is an abundant living pipeline connecting you directly to Jesus. And He's trying to shoot that abundant life through the pipeline directly to you. But something may have it clogged up. Lord willing, at 1 o'clock this afternoon, we'll talk about how your clog might be negative influences, negative people in your life, and what to do about that. But for this worship hour, I want us to think about the possibility that you have been wronged, that you've been hurt, that you've been wounded, and you've been unable heretofore to forgive those hurts. And that inability to forgive has clogged up your spiritual abundance lifeline. And that abundant life that Jesus came to give you is not flowing freely to you because it's clogged up by an unwillingness to forgive. And I want us to talk about the great need to forgive whatever's been done to you, whoever it is, whatever it was, to finally, once and for all, forgive it and let it go and be done with so you can move on with your life and embrace abundant living. And I wonder if our inability to forgive is preventing us from enjoying that abundant living. When I got in my vehicle to come down here this morning, I turned on the radio. You know, my vehicle, it's like a teenager's vehicle. It won't operate unless the radio's on. The first thing you do is you turn the radio on. Then you put it in drive and go. I love to listen to the radio. But you know what? If they're playing music I don't like, I change the station. If I'm listening to talk radio and I don't like it, I change the channel. I listen to what I want to listen to. I don't listen to what I don't want to listen to. And that's the way it is in life. You can tune in to that negative station in your life. You can listen to all of that stinking thinking in your own mind. You can tune in to negative feelings from your own soul about something that somebody did to you. He did this to me, and you'd understand why I can't forgive, preacher, if you knew what she did to me. And they haven't asked for forgiveness, and they don't deserve forgiveness, and I'm withholding forgiveness, and I'm never going to forgive them. You can keep listening to that negative station and go on not really knowing what it's like to fully enjoy abundant life in Jesus Christ. Or you can choose to change the channel and listen to a more positive station. Listen to your own feelings and thoughts, but analyze them critically. And if they're negative, if they're dragging you down, if they're keeping you from enjoying abundant life, then quit listening to them. Talk back to your own negative feelings. Challenge your own negative self-talk and engage in more positive self-talk. Change the channel and learn how to forgive so that you can be free. As long as you are unwilling to forgive, you will never be free from that hurt. You'll always be a prisoner to it. You'll always be chained to it. And I decided a long time ago, I'm going to quit that stinking thinking. I'm going to forgive every wrong that's ever been done to me, whether they want forgiveness or not, whether they've repented or not, whether they've asked for it or not, for my sake, not for them, but for my sake, for my emotional health and spiritual joy and happiness, I'm going to let it go. I'm going to forgive it. And I'm going to claim real, joyful, abundant living. Look with me at Galatians chapter 5 for a few minutes. In Galatians chapter 5, Paul tells us we can choose to live one of two ways. Are y'all turning to Galatians 5 now? Come on, rattle those pages for me. Rattle your Bible pages. Even if you're not going to turn to Galatians 5, rattle your pages. It sounds good. You young folk that got electronic Bibles, push those buttons. Let's look at God's Word together this morning. Galatians chapter 5, we've got two choices. I can choose to live by the desires of the flesh, or I can choose to follow the Spirit of God. It's my choice which one I'm going to do. But if I choose to follow the flesh and gratify the desires of the flesh, the results are going to include things like what are mentioned in verses 19 and 20. And I put a few of those things straight out of the English Standard Version on the screen. If I follow the desires of the flesh, it's going to produce in me things like enmity and strife and jealousy and anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, and envy, and such like. And Paul says, as I've warned you before, so say I now again, that those who do such things cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Look at those things straight out of the Bible on the screen there. These are exactly the kind of things that an unwillingness to forgive produces within our hearts and within our lives. And I can choose to follow the flesh and refuse to forgive the wrongs that have been done to me, and I can go through life carrying all these things in my heart. Or I can learn to forgive and set myself free from those things and enjoy abundant living. It's my choice to choose to instead to follow the flesh, to follow the Spirit of God. Now let me show you some terminology here. Look at verse 16 where he says, walk by the Spirit. And look at verse 18 where he says, led by the Spirit. And look at verse 25 where he says, live by the Spirit. And also in verse 25, keep step with the Spirit. And the Bible tells me here that if I will walk by the Spirit of God, it will produce the fruit of the Spirit of God. If I choose to be led by the Spirit, it's going to produce love and joy and peace. I want love and joy and peace. I don't care what anybody's done to me or how bad it was or how much it hurts or how wrong it is. I want love and joy and peace. And so I choose to forgive it and let it go and move on. I'm going to live by the Spirit so that I can have patience and kindness and goodness. I choose to keep in step with the Spirit of God so that my life and my heart is full of faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. Have you done it yet? Have you memorized our memory verses? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 to 18. I challenge you to memorize those before you leave after the 1 o'clock service today. They're very easy to remember. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 through 18. I'm not going to let what people have done to me that was wrong, that hurt me, that beat me down, that betrayed me. I'm not going to let those things keep me from rejoicing always and praying without ceasing and always giving thanks in every circumstance. Now, I understand there is a debate about whether or not I have to forgive somebody who doesn't repent and ask for forgiveness. And I fully understand the arguments there. Somebody said, I don't have to forgive that person because they haven't repented. They haven't asked me for forgiveness. And they'll say, listen, God only forgives when you repent. And this person hasn't repented of what they did to me, so I'm going to withhold forgiveness from them. And I know what Jesus said in Luke 17, verses 3 and 4. In Luke 17, 3 and 4, Jesus said, if a man repents, you must forgive him. I know that the Bible says those things. But consider a couple of other things. Incorporate some other thoughts into this thinking before you decide. There are two kinds of forgiveness that I'm talking about this morning. There is human forgiveness that we humans can choose to grant. And there is divine forgiveness that only God can give. And I'm talking mainly today about the choice to give human forgiveness. You can't give divine forgiveness. You can't absolve somebody from their sins. If they've wronged you, and even if they come to you and ask for forgiveness, if they don't go to God for forgiveness, they're still not forgiven by God, even if you forgive them. Only God can wash sins away. Only the Lord can absolve somebody from the guilt of sin. You and I can't do that anyway. I'm not talking about giving people the kind of forgiveness God gives. I'm talking about giving them human forgiveness for your sake, for your sanity, for your emotional health, so you can enjoy abundant living. So I'm talking about giving human forgiveness. And in Luke 17, verses 3 and 4, Jesus did not say you don't have to forgive the person who doesn't repent. That passage doesn't deal with the person who doesn't repent. That passage is dealing with the person who does repent, and obviously we're obligated to forgive if they do. But that scripture doesn't deal with people who are not asking for forgiveness. But let me give you a couple of verses that do deal with what to do if a person has not asked for forgiveness. In Luke 23 and verse 34, while they were killing him, for those Roman soldiers, Jesus prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Now we all know, as well as Jesus knew, that the Father cannot absolve those soldiers of their sins unless they repent. But Jesus was a human being. He was the Son of God, but He was in a human form. And He was offering a spirit of human forgiveness even to those who were crucifying Him. Now, folks, I don't recall the Bible saying that they drove a spike through His flesh, then asked for forgiveness for that one, and then said, "Here's another one. Now, here, give me forgiveness for that one. Now let me give you another one." I don't recall that happening. And yet, from the cross, Jesus extended human forgiveness. And Stephen followed the example of Christ, the first Christian martyr in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 7, the Jews were stoning him to death. And he prayed with his dying breath as he fell to his knees, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them. Don't charge them with this sin." That's exactly what Jesus did for his executioners. And I don't recall Acts 7 saying, "Here's a stone upside the head. Forgive me for that one. Now here's another one." They weren't asking forgiveness any more than the Roman soldiers were asking Jesus for forgiveness. But both Jesus and Stephen were offering a spirit of forgiveness, human forgiveness. And that's what I'm challenging us to do, to be like Jesus. Forgive them even though they haven't asked for it, even though they haven't repented, even though they don't deserve it, forgive them anyway. To be like Stephen, I'm going to have that forgiving spirit anyway. Now perhaps you're still back there in Galatians 5, and I want to go back and ask you to turn over a couple of pages to Ephesians chapter 4, and let's read verses 30 and following. Ephesians 4, 30 to 32. Here, Paul talks about the Holy Spirit. And we just read from Galatians 5 about following the Spirit and how if we do that, it'll produce love and joy and peace. Now look at Ephesians 4 and verse 30. "Do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you along with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God in Christ Jesus has forgiven you." To forgive others the way God in Jesus has forgiven us is to forgive even though they don't deserve it. I know you might be thinking, "Mike, if you just knew what they did to me, you would know they don't deserve it." And I understand. I'm not making light of the harm that was done to you. I know it's tough and it hurts and it's wounded you. Perhaps you've been wounded in more ways than one. And they don't deserve your forgiveness. That's why you need to forgive them. By virtue of the definition of mercy It can't be something they deserve. If it were something they deserved, it wouldn't be mercy. It wouldn't be grace. Because grace and mercy is something you need, not what you deserve. And that's the forgiveness we got. We didn't deserve Christ's death on the cross. And when Paul wrote to the Romans, he said, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Unpenitent sinners. We didn't deserve it. And yet Christ died for us anyway. And that's what I'm challenging us to try to do. To forgive those who don't deserve it for our own sake and happiness. If you're following your outline inside the bulletin, number one says, let your bruises heal. Turn your sad emoji to a happy emoji. Let those bruises heal. So let me ask you to think within yourself, what's been done to you? How have you been hurt? Did somebody divorce you? Did you get betrayed? Did you have a bad childhood experience? Did somebody steal your childhood away from you? Were you mistreated in various and sundry ways? Did anybody walk out on you? Did anybody abandon you? Have you been cheated in business or cheated in some other way? And it's left bruises that just haven't healed. What do you do to let your bruises heal? I had a rough March last spring. Last March, I passed 5 kidney stones. I ended up in the ER getting so many IVs, it just kind of ruined that hand for about a month. And when I was able to go back to church, I forgot about how much my hand still hurt from all those IVs. And I reached out and shook hands with the guy in the church at Camden that is the strongest handshaker of any hand you've ever shook, and he about put me on my knees. And after that, I grimaced when I shook anybody's hand. Even after my hand completely healed for a couple of weeks, I still grimaced because I still remember the pain that man inflicted on me when he shook my hand. And that's the way our emotional bruises are too. Whoever said, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names can never harm me, I guess has never been treated like some of us have been treated, because they do hurt. And it takes a while for those emotional bruises to heal. It's not going to happen just because I came and preached this sermon today. It's not going to happen today. But with God's help, if you will let your bruises heal, if you will just decide once and for all to turn out the unforgiveness radio station and tune into the forgiving radio station and just decide to forgive, in time, those bruises will fade and they will heal. I took a church group from Camden up to the Discovery Center at Union City, Tennessee, pretty neat place. And there was this mock old-timey village, and they had a church with a church bell. And every kid in the park that day came by and pulled that rope and rang that bell. I believe there were 14,000 children that rang that bell that day. And I was about to get tired of it, and I said, Missy, let's go on to another part of the park. They just wouldn't quit clanging that bell. They wouldn't turn loose of that rope. And even when you turn loose of that rope, it still keeps clanging on its own from the motion that you began. And that's the way some people are. They keep pulling on that rope of what's been done to them. And they keep ringing that bell and clanging that bell of the hurt and the harm that was done. And I'm just asking you, is it not getting on your nerves, pulling on that rope and clanging that bell? Just clang, 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 clang over and over again. When you decide to quit pulling on that rope of what's been done to you and how bad you've been hurt, that bell's still going to keep ringing for a while. But it's going to get softer, and the rings are going to be fewer and farther in between until finally you won't hear that bell ringing much anymore. Not until you go back and start yanking on that rope again. What I'm asking you to do is, whether that person forgives it or not, forgive it anyway for your sake. Quit pulling on the rope. Turn it loose. Let it go. Let your bruises heal over time. You've already let that person hurt you. You didn't let them. They did it. They hurt you. They've already hurt you terribly. Why continue letting them hurt you by continuing to pull on that rope? I decided some time ago I was going to quit giving control of my joy and happiness to the people in my life who've hurt me. They've already hurt me bad enough by what they did to me. I'm not going to give the joy and happiness of the rest of my life over into their hands. I've forgiven it. I've turned it loose. I've let it go. I've put it at the foot of the cross. And despite what they've done, I'm determined to be happy. I'm determined to receive and embrace the life that Jesus came to give, John 10:10, and to embrace it more abundantly. I could tell you about a woman who was hurt by a man, and now she doesn't trust any man. She's going to punish every man because of what one man did to her. But let me ask you, who's she really punishing? Who is she really hurting? I could tell you about a young man who went off to a Christian college his first semester and poured his heart out to serving God in a local congregation. And everything was great, and he had a girlfriend, and he had a best friend. And a couple of weeks before the Christmas holiday, he found out his girlfriend was seeing his best friend behind his back. In fact, she had just been using him to get to his best friend all along. And now, 2 years later, he's still mad at them and still mad at God and blames God. He's let what happened to him 2 years ago steal his abundant life in Jesus Christ. And no matter how many times I try to reason with him, God didn't do this to you. God doesn't do bad things. Do y'all say amen here? I'm going to say that again and see if you can say amen. God doesn't do bad things. Bad people do bad things. Sometimes good people do bad things. Have you done anything bad? But God never does bad things to good people. But He takes the bad things that are done to them if they will let Him. If they will trust in the Lord and lean not on their own understanding, God will take what's happened to them and heal that wound and even bring something good out of it in time. That's the promise of God's providence in our lives. Romans 8:28. We know, we're certain, we're assured that all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to His purpose. I could tell you about a couple of church members up at Camden who got their feelings hurt by what a church member or two did to them or didn't do for them, and now they don't trust anybody at church and they don't come anymore. And I'll go and visit them and I say, there's about 10 or 12 different churches of Christ within driving distance. Which one are you attending? Well, we're not really going anywhere right now. And they're going to punish the whole Camden Church of Christ for what a couple of people did. But who are they really punishing? Who are they really hurting by refusing to forgive? I could tell you about a woman who was abused by her dad. Can you imagine that? A father doing that to a daughter. She's grown up now, but she continues to keep a chip on her shoulder. She's determined to do that for the rest of her life. She has alienated herself from the rest of the family because if you have anything to do with her father, she won't have anything to do with you. And her life is ruined, not just by what her father did, but by her refusal to let it go and move on. I could tell you about another girl who was abused by her dad, but she took a totally different approach. She chose differently. For a while, she was like that first lady. She went through life with a chip on her shoulder, but finally she got sick and tired of living like that, and she wanted abundant life. So she drove across town and knocked on the door of her dad's house. She hadn't seen him for years. He had never asked for forgiveness, and she went in that house and she said to him, "I forgive you for everything you ever did to me. I'm putting it behind me once and for all." And her life changed. Well, before long, she met a young man. She got married. She had three children. Now those children are raised and she's running a successful business and she's living the abundant life. And she'll tell you to this day, the point in time where her life turned around is when she chose to forgive the man who didn't deserve it and didn't even ask for it. Not for his sake. Not for his washing away of his sins, because he's got to go to God for that as well as to her. But to forgive him for her sake, for her health, so she could move on. I could tell you about Joseph. And if there's ever been a guy that deserved to harbor bitterness toward somebody, it was Joseph to harbor bitterness toward his brothers, but he didn't do that. He's like Ephesians 4, 31. Let all bitterness be thrown away from you. Not just the bitterness that somebody caused that they don't deserve forgiveness, but all bitterness, even bitterness that folks that have caused you and won't repent of, even that bitterness should be put away from us. Ephesians 4, 31. And so Joseph said, I know you put me in that hole in the ground, and I know you wanted to kill me, and I know you sold me into slavery, and I know Potiphar's wife lied about me and had me thrown into prison. But look at me lately. How do you like me lately? I'm now governor of Egypt. And though you brothers of mine meant it for bad and for evil, God used it for good. And now I forgive you, even though you don't deserve it. Luke 4, verses 18 and 19 that we looked at in the Bible class hour, where Jesus reads from Isaiah 61 and proclaims release for captives and setting free the oppressed. Jesus wants to set you free from the oppression of what's been done to you. He wants to set you free from captivity, from the wounds and the bruises and the hurts that have been caused you. But you have to choose to be free and to take the abundant life He wants to give you. Let God settle your account. Romans 12, 19, God says, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. I'm not in God's business of seeking vengeance. I'm in the business of letting God take care of settling my account. Hebrews 10 and verse 30, the Lord will judge His people. God will settle the cases of His people. Our God is a God of justice, and He will make the wrongs right. You know what it's my job to do? Not get back at or punish the people that wronged me. What it's my job to do is to love my enemies and pray for those who persecute me. Jesus said in the red letters in Matthew 5, 44, when you pray for those who have hurt you, do you really pray for them by name? There are some people that have hurt me, that have so wronged me unfairly in days gone by, that it was hard for me to even name their name without spitting or tasting gall in the back of my throat. And it was not until I could name their name in prayer that I began to heal from what they did to me. Pray for those who have hurt you and love even your enemies. I could tell you about a young man who grew up with an alcoholic father who beat on his mother. And when this young man turned 14, he finally got between his dad and his mom to protect his mom. And his dad beat him up, and then kicked him out of the house at age 14. Now, what would you do if you were kicked out of your house at age 14? There's a decision to be made, and the rest of your life's going to be determined, not by what your dad did to you, but by the decision that you're going to make as to how you're going to respond to what your dad did to you. What are you going to do? This young man became a preacher. And he hadn't seen his dad ever since he got kicked out of the house. But one day he was preaching, and during the invitation, somebody stepped out in the aisle and started coming forward. And it was his dad coming to ask for forgiveness and to explain how his dad was an alcoholic and his dad had beat him up so bad. And that doesn't justify what he did to his young man, to his young son, but it does help explain it. But his son had forgiven him long before and moved on with his life. Listen to this. Hurt people hurt people. Think about what that means. Hurt people hurt people. That doesn't justify the hurt they've caused you, but it might explain it. And it doesn't put a salve over all of your wounds and hurts. but it might help you understand. I wonder what has caused them hurt. And who's going to break the cycle of hurt in that chain? You can do that. You can choose to respond to the hurt that's been done to you in a more positive way than those who came before you. Remember always Psalm 17 and verse 8, that you are the apple of God's eye. If God had a wallet, your picture would be in it. I know in my counseling experience that a lot of victims feel guilty. What is there about that phenomenon psychologically that those who did nothing wrong and were victimized somehow feel guilty, like it's their fault? Let me tell you, it's not your fault. And God loves you, and you are not damaged goods. No matter what somebody else has done to you, God loves you. He has always loved you. And He's been there with you in the middle of your pain every step of the way. He has hurt with you. You are a child of the Most High God. Don't blame yourself or feel guilty about the injustices that others have done to you. You're still God's prized possession. Shake off the shame and the blame, and don't let bitterness and blame take root. Don't let those who have victimized you continue to rob you from your joy and happiness. Let it go, be done with it, and move on with abundant living. And let God compensate you. Not only will He take care of your enemies in time, He will pay you back for everything they've ever done to you. In Isaiah 61, again, that passage we looked at earlier, in verse 7, when the Israelites come out of Babylonian captivity and they go back home, God's going to not give them shame, but instead give them double honor. Instead of confusion, He's going to give them rejoicing. And they're going to possess a double portion in the land and everlasting joy. If you try to settle your own account against those who have wronged you, you're not going to get very much blessing or satisfaction out of it. But if you let God settle the account and let Him pay you back and compensate you, you'll get twice as much blessing and compensation than you'll ever exact out of it yourself. Get on God's payroll and let Him pay you back for what's been done. The example prayer, Matthew 6:12. Lord, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We have to be willing to forgive. And I like that terminology. It's financial terminology. Forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. Let me encourage you, last of all, to think about taking that bill that somebody owes you and marking it with a big red stamp. Now, I know you young guys and you young gals don't remember these days, but back before the advent of smartphones and laptops, when a bill was paid, a CPA or somebody would take a big red stamper, rubber stamp, press it into red ink, and then stamp that bill, paid in full. You don't owe it anymore. And that's what I'm challenging you to do today. In your mind's eye, right here, right now, imagine writing a bill of what you're owed by the people who've hurt you. Every wrong that's ever been done to you, what you are owed. Can you take that big red stamp in your mind and stamp that bill paid in full? I'm done with it. You don't owe me anything anymore. For my sake, I forgive it. I hope you'll go to God for your sake and get forgiveness. But whether you ever do that or not, I'm done with it. I'm moving on with abundant living. Make the debt owed you paid in full. You go to the plane, go to the airplane, go to Guyana, or go to Liberia with me in West Africa this March. I'd love to take you to Liberia. The Ebola is gone. I was over there when the Ebola started and got out pretty quick. And it's gone now, and I'm going back. Love to take you with me. But when I go get on that plane to go to Liberia, West Africa, if I take extra baggage, I can take extra baggage, but guess what? I'm going to pay for it. And you could take extra baggage through the rest of your life with you. All that baggage and burden of all the hurt that's been done, You can carry that with you the rest of your life and be downtrodden and weighed down. It's your choice. But you'll pay for it. And I encourage you, just unload it right here and now. Just forgive it. Just let it go. Just be done with it. Lay it at the foot of the cross. I wonder in an audience this size if there's not somebody that needs to be baptized. Do you believe that Jesus rose from the dead? Are you willing to turn from the sin in your life? If you're willing to come forward during the invitation song, we're authorized by Scripture to baptize you, to wash your sins away. Won't you arise and be baptized and wash away your sins? Acts 22:16. Maybe you have been baptized for remission of sins. Is there something clogging up your abundant living pipeline? Disappointments, discouragement, bad things that's happened, bad people that have hurt you. Might even be somebody sitting across the aisle from you that hurt you. I don't know. Sometimes even God's people don't act like they should. But are you willing to come during this song and ask for the prayers of the church to unclog that pipeline so that you can receive abundant life? Don't you want that? We're going to ask our brothers to put up our song and Nathan to come up and lead it. As we stand and sing, we invite you to come.
How deep the Father's love. Yeah.
you bow with me, please? Our Heavenly Father, at this time we come to you in prayer, in this time of our worship, thanking you for your Son, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for your love for us so much that you would send your only Son. Father, we're so thankful. We're mindful, Father, of the suffering that Christ went through on our behalf. We pray now as we partake of this bread, which represents his body that hung on the cross, that we would examine ourselves. We would partake in a worthy manner. We ask all this in Christ's name. Amen.
Father, we're thankful for this fruit of the vine, which represents the blood that your Son and our Savior shed on the cross for us. Father, we're reminded this morning of that sacrifice that was made. We're reminded of that blood that unites us in Christ. And as we, like Christians throughout the world today, remember that sacrifice, may we do so, Father, in a way that brings honor and glory to you and reminds us of the love that you have for us. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.
This concludes the Lord's Supper. If you would, bow with me once again. Our Heavenly Father, again we come to you, thanking you, Father, for all the many blessings you bestow on us. We're thankful, Father, for the health that you give us. We're thankful, Father, for providing for us and allowing us to have jobs. And we pray, Father, that each of us would give back to you cheerfully. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning, and thank you for being here this morning. To those of you who are visiting with us, we're especially happy that you're here, and we want you to come back and worship with us every chance you get. Now, normally we'd be back at 6 p.m. on Sunday night, but today we're going to be back at 1 o'clock to hear Brother Mike Eaton because we're going to eat a fantastic meal immediately following these services. So please stay and enjoy a great meal. And then at 1 o'clock, hear a great sermon. We had 297 in Sunday school this morning. Classes that were 100% were the toddlers. In worship, we had 396. There are several people that we need to remember in prayer. Cassie Stewart is in the hospital in Corinth, and the family had requested prayer for her. And Sue Grizzard is this Elsie Miller's mother. She fell yesterday and was injured, and the family had requested that we remember her. And JT and Scott are on the mission to Guyana. They've already had 8 baptisms, so let's be sure and keep them in our prayers also. I have a letter. Dear church family, we want to thank you from the bottom of our hearts for the food, gifts, visits, and prayers you so freely shared with us during my accident and surgical procedure. Each day I am feeling stronger and hope to be back to my old self very soon. Please keep us in your prayers as I continue to recover. Signed, Maydeen Crowe. And that is all the announcements I have. Would you please stand for our closing prayer? Our dear, most kind, and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we do once again thank you for this wonderful day you've given us and the opportunity we've had to come out and study your word once again. Lord, we pray that what we've learned today, may we apply it to our hearts, and may as a result, we better serve you. Lord, we ask your blessings upon the sick of our number. You know their hearts and their needs. Lord, we ask that you'd bless them. And Lord, we ask that if it be your will, you would restore their health. Lord, thank you for your son Jesus who died on the cross of Calvary for the sins of the world. Now, Lord, as we're about to partake of a great meal, Lord, we ask that you would bless this food. Bless it to the nourishment of our bodies. Bless those who prepared it. Now, Lord, forgive us wherein we have sinned against you. For this we ask in Christ's name. Amen.